Hello again, Irish fans. Happy New Year and welcome to this week's edition of Inside Notre Dame Basketball with Mike Brand. Coach, what a great way to start 2020 with a hard-fought, gritty, dramatic win on the road at Syracuse.
Well, probably one of our better wins since I've been here, Jack. You know, just two teams going at it, a great offensive show. Both teams making shots, but very proud of how our group finished in front of 25,000 people.
Your first ACC conference win of the year. So many stars in the game, but one guy certainly stood out. John Mooney had a monster 28-point, 14-rebound game to earn ACC Player of the Week honors for the second time this year.
Well, you know, he's had a lot of great games here for us, but that may be his best game. You know, he physically and thoroughly dominated the paint, a big putback to put us up two with 18 seconds to go. So, again, he's playing like a Player of the Year candidate. He gives you everything he has.
One of the most entertaining games I have ever had the honor of calling on the radio side. And when we come back, we're going to take you to the Carrier Dome, where the Fighting Irish stunned nearly 20,000 Syracuse fans with a very big win. Inside Notre Dame Basketball is presented by TireRack.com and brought to you by Coca-Cola, Under Armour, Gatorade, Vivid Seats, Canon, and Sirius XM.
That was an unbelievable college game, wasn't it?
Prentice Hupp going to the line for the biggest free throws of his young life. Four dribbles, spins it, lets it go. It is good! 4-point Notre Dame lead, 88-84. 18 seconds left in regulation time. Out to Girard, three on the way. But Notre Dame still leads by one. They inbound the ball. It's over. It's over. Notre Dame has won one of the most dramatic games in Irish history.
Let's get out and go.
Nothing to lose. 1, 2, 3.
Yeah. Back to Hupp. Top of the key, Fluger. Baseline Mooney for the two-handed jam. Notre Dame's on the board.
Exactly how you want to attack this zone.
And his pass is knocked away by Fluger into the hands of Hupp. Hupp, right foul line extended. Hupp back to Gibbs. Gibbs running three. Got it. Gibbs is in fuego. Fluger knocks it away. Loose ball picked up by Hupp. Hupp goes in for the finger roll that's up and good, and that breaks the streak. Rebound comes on out to Gibbs, who bats it over to Hupp. Shovels it back to Lucheski, running three. Got it! And we're tied at 37 with 1:28 remaining. And his 3-point is banked in. Notre Dame, they trail Syracuse at halftime.
Let's go, man! Who we gonna be? Come on! Come on!
Hey, come on! Hupp to Mooney. Nice pass inside. Durham goes up strong, puts it up and in. Notre Dame's back on top. Jump hook, no good. Tipped up and in by Goodwin, and he gets fouled. Dave comes through when they needed him most. The Irish keep hanging in there. Hupp for three. Got it! 1-point game again, 76-75. Hupp, now to Goodwin, turnaround jumper. No good. Rebound, Mooney. Puts it up. No good. Gets the rebound, puts it up and in. Notre Dame leads. 86-84.
You talk about finishing like that. We just have too much firepower. Now we know what it feels like.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I'm really proud of you. Hell of a thing to build on. Let's lock up.
Lock up.
And get on out of here. Great job, everybody.
Yes, sir.
Great job, everybody. Let's bring it in.
In your three home games before you went out to Syracuse, your team had hit 48 threes. You knew you had to do something like that against the Orange, and you did. The guys hit 15 of 31 threes.
Well, we stepped up and made them. We're a very good passing team, Jack, and we find open people, and you have to pass well against the zone. We had 26 assists, but I love the confidence in our shooters the other night.
You've been passing it well all year, and that's the difference. You're starting to make your shots, and a guy who's consistently scoring now is T.J. Gibbs. He hit three straight threes early in this game, won a 4-point play, as you were able to take a 12-6 lead.
He's almost been our designated jump start guy. You know, he gets out early, he makes shots early. We do a very good job of finding him, and he has now taken that shot with set feet. He's a key for us.
You built the lead to 9 twice in the first half. The second time on a Nate Lucheski three. He had a really good game for you. He hit a couple of threes, grabbed 2 rebounds, dished out a nice assist, blocked a shot. The kind of performance you need from him.
Yeah, we're going to need him to keep getting better, and I believe he is. I thought his defense in the last minute, switching out on shooters, getting the big defensive rebound to secure the win, was fabulous. He continues to grow as a college basketball player.
Now, Syracuse bounced back to take their largest lead of the game late in the half, 34-28, and then Rex Fluger did what Rex Fluger does, made a great diving steal, got it ahead to Hupp for a fast break layup, but then you lose Fluger on the play for the rest of the game.
Typical Rex Fluger play, a hustle play, a collision at half court which bruises his knee, but he has the presence of mind to tip it ahead to Prentice to get us a bucket. But yet we have to play the second half now without Rex.
And with just 7 scholarship players, but no worry. Captain John Mooney steps up and scores your first 7 points to get you the lead back.
You know, he just was a physical marvel at a level I had not seen in that paint. He was all over the place, rebounding the basketball, rotating over defensively, making every clutch rebound on both ends of the floor.
Big second half for Juwan Durham, and his final line was remarkable. 10 rebounds, a couple of assists, 3 blocks, 6 points. He had an incredible plus-minus of plus 18.
Yeah, he is a key for us, and I do feel he's starting to feel more confident and feel like he belongs. You know, it was a slow process getting him to this point. Injuries, transfer, all of the above. He's no different than our sophomores in his development. We just got to keep working with him.
A little later, you're down one when Prentice Hub makes a great feed to John Mooney to get the lead back, but then Prentice celebrates just a little too much.
Little too much, crossed the line, and you know, the emotion those kids play with out there, especially in the Carrier Dome with 25,000, you know, sometimes gets you a little overly emotional, and I thought he did. He knew it right away that he made a mistake. Problem was, he kind of woke up Joe Girard and he went on a run, but Prentice Hub woke himself up and finished the game for us.
Now, the 2 free throws on the tee for Syracuse gave him the lead back, and I could see it in Hub's eyes. He felt bad. He thought he had let his team down. A lot of guys would have been crushed. He was not crushed. He came back and hit 2 huge, deep threes, including one that tied the game at 84 with just 120 left.
Well, you know, more I watch Prentice Hub, you know, as he's developing this season, he is a big-time winner. He's becoming a leader. He's got a great mental toughness about him. And to react to the technical the way he did and finish the game for us is really something I'm extremely proud of.
And I think helps him make a big leader of this team.
No question. He is the guy now in our huddles. He's talking as much as TJ, Rex, or Johnny. You know, he's got the ball up there. He's the quarterback. And those seniors now have kind of said, go ahead and run the show and tell us where to be.
You get a stop, and then you have a great offensive possession, which results in 2 offensive rebounds by John Mooney and the go-ahead basket.
You know, we get the ball to the foul line, which we did. We were doing a great job of getting the ball to the foul line against their zone, and then it puts Johnny down low in a position to really rebound, and he just physically dominated. It was a Johnny Mooney kind of play to take the lead.
So that puts you up 86-84. You get another stop. Nate Leshefsky gets a huge rebound, gets it to Hub, who gets fouled. Now, Hub this year was 5-for-12 from the free throw line. He goes down the floor and he makes both free throws, and those end up being the winning points.
And I don't think they hit any rim. Both free throws were nothing but net. His eyes were, I love that I'm in this position. That's a special guy. We really have something special in Prentice Hub developing here early in the ACC season to step up and want to stick those free throws. And then certainly back on the other end, we defend in our green defense where we switch and challenge threes. They tried to draw fouls. We didn't give them a chance to do that. And we escaped from the Carrier Dome with a heck of a league win.
One of the great gritty wins in your tenure, 88-87 at the Carrier Dome over Syracuse. As we go to break, let's go into Notre Dame's victorious post-game locker room.
They don't want no smoke at all, nothing.
We just have too much firepower. I don't know how many assists we had. Had to be in the 20s. But we did a really great job in green once we got into it.
Yes, sir, Nate.
All right?
Yo, you too, bro.
And for our group, you know, we needed something like this.
Yep.
I'm like, when do we get jump-started? We needed a road win against a good team and we played to jump-start us. Let's use this to jump-start us. Because I'm telling you, the way we play and share it and move it, And then when we have to guard, like, we don't have 10 guys, so sometimes we're tired on D. I'm really proud of you because you deserve it. You put yourself in position in these games, and we finally got over the hump, and I think now we know what it feels like. Yes,
sir. Right. Sir,
I'm really proud of you. Hell of a thing to build on. Let's lock up.
Lock up.
And get on out of here. Great job, everybody.
Yes, sir.
Great job, everybody.
Let's bring it in.
Proud of you, man. Way to be men. Way to be men. Father, thank you for helping us play together as a unit and keeping us away from injury. In your name we pray.
Amen.
1, 2, 3.
I'm talking big time.
I finished my breakfast, lunch, and dinner.
What you do?
Breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Eating that up.
Now, the hope, of course, was that the momentum and confidence that you gained at Syracuse would stay with you as you went down to NC State, and it did, even though you played without Rex Pfluger and Nick Jogo was nursing a sprained ankle.
Yeah, I mean, we were thin. You know, we knew we weren't going to have Rex. We're trying to get this bruise, you know, calmed down. But again, we got off to a great start offensively. We were in our rhythm. You know, we scored 39 points in the first half. We're making shots. We're moving the ball. We had to play a lot of zone, I think, to help us with our depth, but to also maybe try and keep Johnson out of the lane as long as we could. But, you know, our lack of depth at times wore on us.
You basically had to go with a six-man rotation. Only 7 scholarship players, but again, Jogo with a sprained ankle. You have a walk-on. That's a tough game to put a very talented walk-on in. But your guards, if you're going to win, your guards played very well again. Hub and TJ Gibbs combined for 24 first-half points. And talk about Hub staying on a roll. He hit 5 of 6 shots in the first half, including 4 threes. You went up by 9.
We were out of the gate, and again, I think Prentice and TJ set the tone. They're really playing well for us right now, and they had to play 40 minutes. There was really no way to get them out of the game. They had to play, and I think zone helped us. We just really couldn't maintain our offensive flow for more than really a half, and that hurt us. Like, to win at NC State the other night, yeah, we gave up some offensive rebounds at a key time, but you got to score 75 or 80 to get out of there, and we couldn't have a second half offensively like we had our first half offensively.
John Mooney, again, was good, physical, until he got into foul trouble. He recorded his 12th double-double of the season, 14 points, 14 rebounds, including maybe the most impressive block shot of his career, where he grabbed the ball and it led to a score.
Yeah, no, he's given us everything he's got. You know, we put him in the middle of the zone, and then when Juwan's in, he's out on the wings and he's having to move his feet. But him rebounding the basketball and protecting the rim was really a key for us. And we got some transition stuff. You know, again, when we can get into some transition offense and not play against a set defense, it does help us.
You shot 54% in the first half. You led by 5 at halftime. You quickly build it up to 12 in the second half. So you were going for a while, and then stuff started to change. And you mentioned, yeah, you got worn down a little bit. I also thought NC State really started to get into you defensively.
They did. They guarded us really. Their defense picked up. And then they got to the offensive boards for us, which is always something I'm concerned about with this team. You heard me talk about before the UCLA game, the hand-to-hand combat zone, that we have to try and win that, or at least neutral, keep it neutral. They won it for a stretch in the second half with second shots that kind of demoralized us. And that is an area for us where we can be weak at times in that area, and we must be better, or we must be really shooting it well on the other end to absorb it.
And one of the reasons you were able to stay with NC State, a big NC State team, was Mooney was physical, but he picked up his 4th foul with 5:25 left. And I really thought at that point you were not going to be able to hold on, and you couldn't.
Yeah, and he's, you know, he and I talked on the plane back. He's got to be smarter about, you know, Johnny needs to stay on the floor for us. And when he gets to 3 fouls, you know, you can't really get a cheap 4th, and you certainly can't get a cheap 5th. You need to stay on the floor for us and not foul and push. And you know, that's an area where, you know, we got to keep talking to him throughout the game. He needs to finish games for us.
Hub finished with a career-high 24 points, but the star of this game was Markel Johnson. Really good down the stretch. He scored 11 points in the final 4 minutes, finished with a game-high 27 points, all the while battling back spasms.
Yeah, he is a great guard, a killer, and an assassin. We tried man, we went back to zone, we doubled the ball screen, we did a little bit of everything, and we really couldn't get any stops enough to escape the thing, even though we still have free throws to take the lead. We have possessions to go up. And I thought we had some good looks from outside in the last 4 minutes that could have swung it back, and we didn't make them. And for us, you know, we're going to have to score more than the 60s to beat ACC teams.
NC State wins at 73-68. They deserve to win. This week, the high confidence-building emotion of winning at Syracuse and the kind of fly-home kicking yourself in the rear that we should have won that game loss, how do you bounce back?
You know, I have a lot of confidence in our group that they'll be really ready to compete today against Louisville. I mean, what a great challenge for us, a big, ranked, physical Louisville team coming in here. Now the hand-to-hand combat zone is going to be tested again because they get up on the backboard. But it's the ebb and flow and up and down of league play. And this last two games, you got the ultimate high and the ultimate low, and you got to come back and try and find some middle ground and be hungry and hold serve at home.
Our fan question for Coach Bray is coming up right after this. It's time now for the experts at TireRack.com. Question of the week for Coach Bray. This week's question comes from Austin Grawl of Wakarusa, Indiana. Coach, do you like the 20-game schedule better than the 18-game schedule in conference play?
Well, I've learned to accept it. It was coming because we needed more inventory for the ACC network, so it was going to happen. With 18 league games, you did have more flexibility for non-league matchups, UCLA, Georgetown, Villanova, things like that. But at the end of the day, we have such an exciting, interesting league. Why not play each other more? Now, there's 15 coaches that are spinning at times with 20 league games, but I think it's good for the league.
Now it's time for us to name our Vivid Seats Performance of the Week. Lots of performances to choose from, and certainly Prentice Hubb has to be a candidate, but it's hard to ignore a guy that put up 28 points, grabbed 14 rebounds at Syracuse to not only earn ACC Player of the Week honors, but the coveted Vivid Seats Performance of the Week award. Here's a look at John Mooney in action this week. No surprise, your team faces another tough week this week. You do get to go home on Saturday, but you have to play a ranked 12-3 Louisville team.
They're really good, really physical. They're going to bang at us at the paint and on the backboard. We're going to have to be better there. And they're really good defensively. Can we get into an offensive rhythm against them? We're going to have to run, get down the floor, and not play against their set defense because it's so physical and so athletic.
Then you have to go down to Georgia to play Georgia Tech. And for whatever reason, this has been an incredibly tough series for you in ACC play. You're 7-5, and all time, Notre Dame's only won once against Georgia Tech in Atlanta. 1-10 all time, you've got the one.
Yeah, we stole one down there. It's been a tough, and we've had heartbreakers down there. Well, they're huge. They're another physical front line, like an NC State, like a Louisville. Yeah, that will be the third game in a row in league play where they will try to pound us in the paint and on the backboard.
Coach, thank you very much. And folks, that will do it for this week's edition of Inside Notre Dame Basketball. We will have all the highlights of the games with Louisville and Georgia Tech on next week's show. Until then, for Coach Bray, I'm Jack Nolan. Thanks so much for watching. And as always, go Irish. Inside Notre Dame Basketball is presented by TireRack.com and brought to you by Coca-Cola, Under Armour, Gatorade, Vivid Seats, Canon, and Sirius XM.